See, if A is a positive matrix, Perron's theorem says that rho of A is always an eigenvalue of A, okay. There is a positive eigenvector associated with the rho of A, okay. Okay, see, in proof I have done this one, 1 and 2 I have done, okay, except that I have not done for, except one small step I have left, okay, see, I left this inequality, okay. Okay, see, if only this inequality is proof I have not done yesterday. Okay, what is M of u? M of u is, okay, see, you take a vector in Cn, okay, to each of the coordinate you take the modulus and then you have M of u. See, if you have u in Cn, okay, if you have a complex vector, M of u will give you a non-negative vector. Okay. A M of u is greater than or equal to M of au. Just, see, proof is nothing, just A M of u, you write down explicitly, okay, A11, A12, A1n, An1, An2 up to Ann. Multiplied by the vector M of u, okay. I am calling the vector V by M, A into M of u, okay. V1, V2, Vn I am writing. See, right hand side I am doing the matrix multiplication, nothing else, okay. Okay, these are the things. So, let me call W as AU, okay. But why I am writing AU, I don't know. Oh, okay, AU, okay, so because I have to compute mod W, okay, AU, I write AU in this way, okay, write down everything, by triangle inequality, first component of A of M of u equal to V1, okay, it is greater than or equal to modulus of A11 into U1 plus modulus, plus A12 into U2, there is no modulus there, okay, till A1n into U1n. There is no line there after A12. Okay. This is equal to mod W1 by my definition, by the previous slide. Okay. See, previous slide W1. This is mod W1 equal to AU, first component of AU. So, I have shown that first component of AU in modulus is less than or equal to A times modulus of U, first component of A times modulus of U. This argument can be, what can you say? See, this argument is valid for any I, not only for the index 1. So, A M of u times I is greater than or equal to A u I for every I, okay. So, ultimately it means that this vector A M of u is dominates A M of A u, okay, that is the meaning for this. A M of u minus A M of A u is always a non-negative vector, okay. So, anyway, that is a proof of this inequality, okay. So, rest of things I have done, okay. So, technique is just a triangle inequality, more than that I have done nothing, okay. So, see, so a triangle inequality technique is very, very simple, very small technique, but very effective and powerful. Okay, these things I have done, okay. See, let me come to the third assertion of the Perron's theorem. Third assertion says that geometric multiplicity of rho of A is less than, is 1. What is the meaning for geometric multiplicity? Geometric multiplicity means geometric multiplicity of an eigenvalue, that is a meaning, okay. What is the meaning for geometric multiplicity of an eigenvalue? Dimension of a null space of A minus lambda I, okay, or in other words, nullity of A minus lambda I, okay. So, geometric multiplicity of rho of A is 1. What is the meaning for that? Nullity of A minus rho of A times I is 1, okay. So, I have to show that dimension of null space of A minus rho of A into identity data is 1, okay. Okay, see, how will you show that space is one dimensional, okay, generated by only one vector, okay, and not only generated by one vector, generated by one non-zero vector, okay. Suppose I take x and y, okay, in the space, null space, okay. I have to show that x and y are linearly dependent, then null space will be one dimensional, nullity is one in other words, okay. Okay, say, how to prove this one here? See, null space of A minus rho of A times I is always a subspace. Do you agree this one or not? Null space of any matrix is a subspace. Column space is always a subspace. Image of a linear transformation is always a subspace. Okay. It's a subspace of what? Null space of A minus rho of A into I, rho of A into I is a subspace of? Subspace of what? Rn or Cn? If A is an n by n matrix, okay. If A is an n by n matrix, then Rn. See, you are dealing, see, this matrix you have to view it as a complex matrix because we are considering vectors in Cn, okay. See, okay, in other words, I can also phrase the statement of the Perron theorem like this. If you have a complex, you can't have a purely complex eigenvector associated with the Perron vector, Perron eigenvalue. Okay. Anyway, see, we'll finish it quickly. Okay. I want to show that x and y are linearly dependent. Okay. Suppose they are linearly independent. Okay. Suppose they are linearly independent. Okay. Suppose they are linearly independent. Okay. See, here I am assuming that x is positive. Okay, already that x positive comes from the first two assertions. Okay, Ax equal to rho of A into x, where x is a positive vector. Okay, now you take another vector y. Okay, y may be in Cn or y may be in Cn. Okay, consider case by case. Okay, first case I am assuming that y is in Rn. Okay, if y is in Rn, okay, anyway, see, this is a trick here. X is positive. Okay, x is positive and the y is a vector in Rn. Okay, I can get a suitable alpha so that some component of x minus alpha I is 0, whereas the vector x minus alpha y remains non-negative. Can I do this one always? You have to use the fact that x is positive, otherwise it is not true. If x is positive, how will you do this one here? X minus alpha y, okay, this ith component should be 0, okay, this gives you the value of alpha also. What is alpha here? Alpha is, alpha is xi, right? Yeah, you are right, xi divided by, okay, xi by yi, okay, then see the, okay, this is a guess. It is not alpha, but how will you define alpha precisely now? How summation comes here? Alpha is minimum of what? Minimum of xi by yi, xj by yj. Okay, xj by yj. But you have to take care that this yj is not 0. So I will put it here. Yj not 0. Okay. I think this is enough, right? Minimum of xj by yj. Okay, xj by yj. So you take this one. Suppose the minimum is attained at x1 by y1. Okay. For instance, you assume that it's x1 by y1. Now can you verify this one? X minus alpha y. Okay. So suppose you are considering the second component. So this is x2 minus x1 by y1 into y2. Okay, but how will you relate it with okay, it may happen that y2 is 0. Okay, anyway, initially assume that y2 is not 0. If y2 is not 0, then this is greater than or equal to x2 minus x1 by y1. So see, anyway, there is a minus sign here. Okay, minus x1 by y1 is greater than or equal to minus x2 by y2, because I am assuming that x1 by y1 is the minimum. Yeah, there is a minus sign here. Okay. So into y2, of course, this is what, 0. This is 0. So I have got greater than or equal to 0. Okay. Greater than or equal to 0. If y2 is already 0, I need not bother. Okay. If y2 is already 0, this is a x2, right? So already positive, x is a positive vector. Okay. Anyway, see, I have a vector now here like this, x minus alpha y greater than or equal to 0, x minus alpha I, y ith component is 0, okay. Okay, one more observation, x minus alpha y is an eigenvector corresponding to rho of A, y. Linear combination of eigenvectors corresponding to the same eigenvalue is once again an eigenvector. So, x minus alpha y is again an eigenvector for A. See, x and y are eigenvectors of A corresponding to the same eigenvalue rho of A. So, x minus alpha y is also an eigenvalue, okay. So, x minus alpha y is an eigenvector of A, okay. A is positive, okay. Yesterday I told you that if you multiply a positive matrix by a non-negative vector, okay, which is not a zero vector, you will get a positive vector, okay. So, A of x minus alpha y is positive, okay. But does it give a contradiction here? Does it give a contradiction? Ith value is a 0, why? Yeah, yeah. See, A of x minus alpha y, okay. This is a, this itself is an eigenvector. So, rho of A into same vector x minus alpha y, okay. Rho of A times x minus alpha y. So, compute the ith component here. Ith component is ith component, okay. And this is rho of A into what is this number? 0. So, this is 0, okay. So, ith component is 0. So, this vector A of x minus alpha y is no longer a positive vector, but the previous statement implies that it is a positive vector. They are contradicting each other. So, there is a, so this cannot happen, okay. So, only possibility is that x must be a multiple of y, okay. X is a multiple of y. See, if it is see, I have shown that if y is in Rn and if y and x are linearly independent, it's not possible. Okay, if y is in Rn, then x and y cannot be linearly independent. That's what I have shown. What happens if I replace this Rn by Cn? Suppose y is in Cn, okay, Ay equal to rho of A into y, okay. Then how will you complete the proof here? The proof is extremely simple because A is, we are starting only with a real matrix, okay. Always we can equate real and imaginary parts, okay. Y is in Cn. Write y equal to p plus I times q. P and q, they come from, they come from Rn. P plus I q belongs to Cn. That means that p is in Rn, q is in Rn, okay. So, the p is a real part of y and q is a imaginary part of y, okay. Compute a times p plus I q, okay. A y equal to rho of A into y. So, rho of A into p plus I times rho of A into q, okay. If you, so, equate the real and imaginary parts. AP should be rho of A into P. AQ should be rho of A into Q. Okay. Now, how will you finish the proof? Now, I am working only in Rn. Can I appeal to case 1 or not? Okay. P should be a multiple of X. Q should be a multiple of X. Okay. So, ultimately, Y should be a multiple of X. Okay. Maybe a complex vector. Okay. See, complex multiple. See, Y is some eta times x for some eta complex number. So, they are linearly dependent. Okay. So, this proves that geometric multiplicity is 1. In fact, I will show that algebraic multiplicity itself is 1. Okay. That later on we will show. But showing that geometric multiplicity equal to 1 is simpler. Okay. Proof is complete. Okay. Final assertion. If A is positive, then there exists x positive such that Ax equal to rho of x. We have shown this one, okay. Or the, also the geometric multiplicity of rho of A is 1. Final assertion says that if you have a positive eigenvector, suppose you find a positive eigenvector, okay, for A, then the corresponding eigenvalue should be the spectral radius. That's the final assertion of the theorem. See, for a positive matrix, randomly if you find a positive vector which is an eigenvector, then the corresponding eigenvalue should be the spectral radius. Anyway, I will give it, leave it as an exercise, okay. It follows only by that A transpose U argument, okay. Apply Perron theorem to whatever you have done for A transpose also, and then subtract the two sides, then you will get this one. This argument already I have done, okay. So, anyway, see, this is the complete proof of Perron's theorem. Perron's theorem is a simple, okay. Once you know Brouwer's fixed point theorem, it's very simple. See, I won't do this one. Okay, maybe I will go to the next irreducible matrices. Okay. Okay, see, irreducible matrices, this itself needs 1 hour, okay, to introduce irreducible matrices, but anyway, we will see the definition very quick, okay. I will start with a matrix, okay, like this. Diagonal entries are zeros, off-diagonal entries are simply one, okay, off-diagonal entries are simply one, okay. What are the spectral properties of this D? Okay, spectral properties, what is the meaning for the word spectral properties? I am looking at the eigenvalues of D and eigenvectors of D, okay. So, how they look like and whether they are positive or how many of them are negative, okay. And how many eigenvectors are positive eigenvectors and etc. and so on, okay. That's all the spectral properties of D, okay. So, now what are the spectral properties of D here? So, if you consider this D, okay. D is a 3E, okay, D is 3E, that's a simple. What is E? E is 111, okay, E is 111, yesterday I told you this, E equal to 111. So, if you apply D, if you calculate D times E, it will give you 3 times E, okay. 3 is the Perron value of D, 3 is the Perron value of D. Perron vector is E, okay, E or any scalar multiple of E, okay. Okay, see, there is a, so I will compute all the eigenvalues of D, okay, D tilde, okay, D tilde is defined as, this, you forget that D, there, I should have deleted this one, this D has no meaning, okay, delete this one. D tilde equal to, I am taking the principal submatrix of D. For a non-negative? Okay, fine. Okay, see what he is telling is correct. For a non-negative matrix, there is no, I have not defined this Perron eigenvalue. Okay, so strictly speaking, anyway, I should not use this word Perron eigenvalue, okay. Anyway, there is a positive eigenvalue, that's enough. That's, not going to do anything with it. Okay. Okay, D tilde, okay, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0. It's a principal submatrix of D. What is a principal submatrix? What is a submatrix first of all? A submatrix, given a matrix A, what is the meaning for a submatrix? Delete some rows and some columns. Okay, then the matrix obtained is called a submatrix. What is a principal submatrix? If you delete a column I, you should delete a row I also. Okay, then the, if you delete a row 1, then you have to delete column 1. If you delete a row 1 and column 1, then you have, sorry. If you delete row 1 and row 2, then you have to delete column 1 and column 2. It's a submatrix obtained by deleting same number of rows and columns. Okay, that's a principal submatrix. Okay, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0. How did I get this matrix? By deleting the last row and the last column of D. Is it alright or not? Okay, so determinant of D tilde, okay, determinant of D tilde is a principal submatrix. Determinant of D tilde is a 2, see, don't bother about this one, I calculated, so I am writing it as a determinant of D tilde equal to 2, I am not telling you directly, okay, you just believe this one, determinant of D tilde is 2, okay, D tilde of 111 is a 2 times 111, of course, this is simple, is it alright, yes, D tilde of 111 is 2 times 1, in fact, I should put transpose there also. On the right hand side, okay. So, D tilde has exactly one positive eigenvalue, okay. D tilde has exactly one positive eigenvalue. So, D tilde has exactly one positive eigenvalue. How I computed is that I computed, okay, by you compute by hand, okay. So, I got this one exactly one positive eigenvalue, okay. So, D tilde has two negative eigenvalues. Okay, so D tilde has two negative eigenvalues. This is simple. See, determinant of D tilde is 2. I know that there is one positive eigenvalue. Okay, then that means that it should have two negative eigenvalues.
Look at the matrix B. Nothing but J minus I. J is the matrix
with
all. J is the matrix with all units 1.
Okay, okay.
The eigenvalues of J minus I will be, since it's a symmetric matrix, eigenvalues of J minus
I. No, no, no. Don't conclude this one. That.
J is the right one matrix.
See, eigenvalues of A minus B always not equal to eigenvalue of A. Maybe work for this special case, okay. For this special case, it may work, okay. But in general, it's not true, okay. But anyway, see, leave this one, okay. It's not a big thing. See, determinant is a 2, okay. If you know that it has exactly one positive eigenvalue, it should have 2 negative eigenvalues then. Otherwise, the determinant will be negative, okay. Anyway, see, there is an interlacing theorem. Okay, I may not explain this one, Professor Babat will tell you this one. In interlacing theorem, D has at least 2 negative eigenvalues. Okay, 2 negative eigenvalues. Right now, don't worry about anything. Accept that D has 2 negative eigenvalues. Okay, I use a MATLAB, I type this matrix and get the eigenvalue. Okay, and I conclude the last statement. D has 3 negative eigenvalues. That is enough for us. Okay. Okay, so now I will list down all the properties. Okay, spectral radius of D is equal to 3. Okay, eigenvector E is positive. Fine, eigenvector corresponding to rho of D is E. Already I told you this is positive. Geometric multiplicity of D is 1. Okay, geometric multiplicity of D is 1. Why? Algebraic multiplicity itself is 1. Okay, now, and for a symmetric matrix, algebraic multiplicity coincides with a geometric multiplicity. Okay. So, all these the matrix I considered is a symmetric matrix. Okay. All the conclusions in Perron's theorem are true for D. So, this matrix, all the Perron's theorem's properties. Okay. But note that D is not a positive matrix. Diagonal entries are going to be zeros. Okay. It is just a non-negative matrix. D is just a non-negative matrix. Okay, so now I can ask you, so does the Perron theorem can be extended to non-negative matrices also? Okay, can you extend the Perron's theorem to non-negative matrices also? No, all the conclusions will not be valid. Why? All the conclusions are not valid. See, always why should I get a positive eigenvector? Okay, suppose you consider 0, 1, 0, 0. Okay. Its spectral radius is 0. Spectral radius of this matrix is 0. 0 times 1, 0. Okay, spectral radius is 0. But what is the eigenvector here? 1, 0. Okay, it's no longer a positive vector. Okay, so just if I simply extend, if I want to extend the Perron theorem to non-negative matrices, it doesn't follow. Okay, I'm interested in matrices for which the Perron theorem is true. Okay, so I have to classify those matrices first. Anyway, see, in the least case, always I can say that for a non-negative matrix, spectral radius will be an eigenvalue. Okay, anyway, this will follow from some more arguments. Okay, not immediate. Anyway, right now accept this one. Okay, non-negative matrices have spectral radius as an eigenvalue. Okay. We will now prove Perron's theorem to a class of non-negative matrices that has a certain form. Okay, that has a certain form. These matrices will be called irreducible matrices. Okay, we have to define what are called irreducible matrices precisely. Proof. I will prove Perron's theorem for irreducible matrices. Sorry, what is that? I will prove Perron's theorem for irreducible matrices. Okay, it's actually proved by Frobenius. Proof will be, I will be appealing to Perron's theorem to get the proof. Okay. So, okay, so naturally, see here if you see this matrix 0, 1, 0, 0, okay, it all depends on this, how these zeros are located, 0, 0, 0 here, okay, 0 here. So, if I want to define irreducible matrices, it should depend on the location of zeros, okay. The matrix, first I will define what is called reducible. Okay, if a matrix is not reducible, then I will call irreducible. Okay, a matrix A is called irreducible if some permutation matrix P, I will explain you what is a permutation matrix, don't worry. Okay, if for some permutation matrix P, P transpose AP has the special form A1, B, 0 and A2, where A1 and A2 are square matrices. See, the motivation, if you want, you take only this simple example, this itself is a motivation. I have a 0 here, this is 1 by 1, this is 1 by 1, this is 0, okay. So, permutation matrix, identity matrix is a permutation matrix, okay. So, this is a matrix which is reducible. This is an example of a reducible matrix. Already I have an example on the board. 0, 1, 0, 0 is a reducible matrix. Irreducible to define, it's very simple now. If a matrix is not reducible, then I will call it as irreducible. Okay, this is. Okay, I will explain you what is this permutation matrix. Okay. Permutation matrix, see, I will come to this example later on. Okay, first I will define what is called a reducible permutation matrix. Okay, see, this term standard basis is always used in this linear algebra again and again. Standard basis for Rn, okay, standard basis for Rn is E1, E2 up to En. E1 is the vector with one in the first position, remaining things are zeros. E2 is 0 in the first position, second one 1, third one zeros and so on. Okay, suppose I am in R3, so E1 is 100, E2 is, and then see, I will always use the superscript, okay, I will not use the subscript. So E1, this is what, E2, I'm sorry, this is E2 and E3. So now you can write down for any n, okay. EA is a vector in which all the entries are zeros except the ith entry. The ith entry is 1, okay. This is a standard basis for Rn. A matrix P is a permutation matrix if and only if, okay, it's a definition I am giving you here. Each column must be an element in the standard basis, okay. Each column should come only from the standard basis. That means if you are writing the first column, okay, it will be one of the vectors E1, E2 or En. Okay, I told you that identity matrix is a permutation matrix. In the identity matrix, what is the first column? Second column is E2 and so on, okay. Second condition that I am going to impose is that P is orthogonal, okay. P is an orthogonal matrix. The orthogonal matrix, all of you know, P transpose P is identity, okay, or equivalently P, P transpose is identity, okay. Or in other words, all the column vectors are orthogonal, or equivalently all the row vectors are orthogonal, okay. Not only orthogonal, they have orthogonal with magnitude 1, okay, magnitude 1. So, these are called orthogonal matrices.
So, if you have the first condition, then did you
get
the second condition automatically?
Okay, fine, yeah. He is alright. Okay, there is no need for this one. P is orthogonal, okay, redundant. Okay, this is redundant. P is orthogonal, there is no need to this one, okay. Each column of P must be an element in the standard basis. Equivalently, I could have done in the row also, okay. Anywhere you can take, it doesn't matter, okay. See, example, E2, E1, E3 up to En is a permutation matrix, okay. So, number of permutations, 1, 2 up to N, how many the permutations are there? N factorial are there, so N factorial permutations will be there. So, if you want to list down all the 3 by 3 permutation matrices, how many matrices will you get? 6, 1 into 2 into 3, 6, okay. If you write down all the 4 by 4 permutation matrices, you will be getting 24 matrices, including the identity matrix, including identity, okay. So, okay, say one small technique with this permutation matrix. Suppose you take any n by n matrix, okay. P is, P equal to, here I have taken the P in a specific way. I have just swapped the first column and the last column. First column and the last column. Remaining things I have fixed. Okay. En, E2, E3 up to En-1. These columns are fixed. Okay. In between those two. Just the first and last column I have swapped. En and E1. Okay. Write V like this. Okay. Write V as first column equal to V1. Second column V2. Third column V3 and so on. Nth column is represented by Vn. Is it all right or not? Okay. See, now I am going to multiply V into P. Okay. V into P. P is a right multiplication. Okay. P comes in the right. VP, if I consider, okay, if I consider VP, then how do you get this one VP? Okay, see this, this is a matrix multiplication, okay, A into B, I am going to multiply two matrices, okay. This, see, this is a technique we teach for our linear algebra students, BTech students, A into, okay, B, I write it as like this, B1, B2, up to Bn, these are the columns of B, okay, B1, B2, up to Bn. So if you write down this one, I will get first column equal to AB1, second column equal to AB2, nth column is ABn. So this is exactly AB. AB is the matrix whose first column is AB1, okay, ith column is ABI, okay. So remember this technique, okay, this is always useful. So now I am multiplying V by P, okay, V by P, and already I have defined P also. So V acting on P will be, what is VP? V of En, okay, V of En, okay. See, I will tell you one more thing here. Okay, A is an n by n matrix. Okay, A is an n by n matrix. See, I want to get, see, on the right hand side, okay, on the right hand side, I want to get the first column. Okay, first column of A. Then what vector should I substitute here so that I get A1? See, A is like this. First column is A1, second column is A2, and so on. Okay. E1, okay, so E1, okay, A1, AX equal to A1 always has a solution, okay, AX equal to A1, okay, A1 is in the column space of A, no, so you should have a solution. AE1 is A1, okay, AE2 is A2. If I want to retrieve the ith column, AEI is AI, okay, it's a very small technique. Anyway, so I will apply this one, VP, okay, VP is matrix V acting on En, matrix V acting on En, okay, so that should give you the nth column of V. Nth column of V is what? Vn, okay, nth column of V is Vn, okay. So apply this one repeatedly, okay, up to n minus 1 you will get the same thing, V2 up to Vn minus 1, last column is going to be V1, okay, VP. So observation is that right multiplication of a permutation matrix rearranges just the columns of V. Rearranges the columns of V. Do you agree this one or not? Look at VP. Just I have rearranged the columns of V. That's all. Okay. Similar way, I can argue and then say that left multiplication of a permutation matrix. Okay. Left multiplication of a permutation matrix rearranges the rows of V. Okay. Okay, see, one more small thing. If P is a permutation matrix, do you agree that P transpose is permutation or not? That is also a permutation matrix. Okay. So P transpose, so if you consider P transpose VP, P transpose VP is orthogonally similar to V. Okay. Not only similar, orthogonally similar to V. P transpose VP will be a simultaneous rearrangement of rows and columns of V. Okay. Rows and columns of V. Okay. Now I will come to the example. Okay, so anyway, see, keep this, keep all these things in mind. Say I will consider this example 0020 0001 0100 1000. This matrix is not reducible. Okay, in other words, this matrix is irreducible. This matrix is irreducible. How to prove this one? It is irreducible. Okay, that's the question now. Okay, consider this matrix A. Okay, I want to show that A is irreducible. Okay, just arbitrarily I will take a P. Okay, I am taking P as this matrix. E2, E1, first two columns are swapped. Okay, E2 and E1, remaining columns are fixed. E2, E1 up to En. Now I am interested in computing P transpose AP. Okay, AP is what? AP will be, first two columns are swapped. Okay, so the second column of A comes and sits in the first column. First column will sit in the second column. So 0010, 0001, and the remaining columns of A are fixed. Third and fourth columns are fixed. Is it all right? So AP is that's all. Okay. AP. See, don't do mechanically. See, you start computing A into P and then compute one by one entry, it will be irritating. Okay, so just use this technique, okay, so if P transpose AP, okay, if you compute P transpose AP, I told you that P transpose AP will be rearrange the rows and columns, okay. So that means the second row will come in the, P transpose AP. So P transpose AP will be, did I write correctly or not, I don't know. Yes, yes, yeah, it's all right, okay, it's all right. First row, see, second row should be the first row now, okay, that I have written correctly. And first row should be the second row, okay. So first row of P transpose AP, okay, should be the second row of AP, okay, which is correct, okay. And the remaining rows are fixed, okay. This matrix is not in the special form, that is in the form like this. So A1 is square, A2 is square, remember this one, A1 is square, A2 is square. This matrix is not in this form, do you agree this one or not? This matrix is not in, okay. So I have proved that it is irreducible, is it all right? Why? Okay, only one permutation matrix I have verified, okay. So how many verifications I have to do? N factorial is how much here? So 24 times I have to do compute, okay. So I will verify 24 times and then conclude that this matrix is not reducible, okay. Is it all right or not? Anyway, see, I will not do this nonsense, okay. 24 times I will not verify, okay. At least one permutation matrix I verified, okay. So to complete the proof, we need to verify for all the permutation matrices. 24 times I have to verify, okay. Don't do this one, okay. See, what you will do is, I will draw the diagraph of A, okay, diagraph of A, okay, diagraph of A, I will do this one. See, for this matrix alone, I will draw the diagraph, okay. So, okay, see now, 1, 1, okay. So, what a number of vertices, there will be 4, because it's a 4 by 4 matrix, okay, 4 by 4 matrix, 2, 3, 4, 3, okay, 1, 2, 3 and 4, okay. Now, 2 and 3, okay, 2 and 3, I will draw, okay, 2 and 3 is non-zero, so I will put here 2 and 3, okay, sorry, not, what is it, so 1 by 1 and 2, right, 1 and 3, 1 and 3, 1 and 3, okay, and then 2, 4, 2 to 4, there is a path, okay, see, just observe that 2 to 4 I can travel, okay, so in that way you draw the graph, 2 to 4 you can go, and then 3 to 2 I can go, okay, 3 to 2 I can go, 4 to 1, 4 to 1 I can go, okay, 4 to 1 there is an edge, okay. See, arrows are very important, okay, not only the edges of the graph, arrows are very important here, so that's why it's a diagraph, okay, directions, directed graph, diagraph, directions are, these arrows are very important, okay. Can I go from 4 to 2? You can definitely go. You see, you can go 4 to 1, 1 to 3, and then 3 to 2. Okay. Can I go from 1 to 2? Okay. 1 to 3. Yeah, 1 to 3, 3 to 2, you can go. Okay. So, this graph is called strongly connected. Okay. This is strongly connected graph. I will say that these kind of graphs are strongly connected. From every vertex, you can go to other vertex. Okay, that's a meaning for strongly connected. Okay, so the matrix, the diagraph that I got is strongly connected. Okay, see the remarkable result which says that this connects graph theory with graphs with irreducible matrices. A matrix is irreducible if and only if it is strongly connected. No, nothing So what is it? Non-negativity doesn't come into the picture at all here. Okay, I don't need any non-negativity here. Okay, any matrix I can call it is irreducible or reducible. Okay, only for Perron Frobenius theorem I need non-negativity. Okay. You need only non-zero entries, no? No, no, for defining reducibility, I am saying. Defining reducibility or irreducibility, there is no need for any non-negative condition or positivity condition. Remember that one, okay? Anyway, see, listen here. Non-negative irreducible matrices and the positive matrices are related, okay? Anyway, before that, yeah, A is irreducible if and only if graph of A, diagraph of A is strongly connected, okay? See, proof. See, if you start writing the proof, it will take another 1 hour. Maybe Professor Bapat will tell you this. Irreducible if and only if strongly connected. Okay. So, you have to write down in terms of graph theoretic arguments. Okay. See, very easy way of reduce for if I apply this theorem, A is irreducible if and only if A is strongly connected, I can easily verify whether it is irreducible or not. At least for 4 by 4, 5 by 5. Do you agree this one or not? 4 by 4 or 5 by 5. Or if you write a simple program, then also it will verify. Okay. Anyway, see, the proof of Perron Frobenius theorem has nothing to do with this graph. Okay, this graph theory ends only with this definition. A is this characterization. A is irreducible if and only if A is strongly connected. Characterization only this graph theory comes here. Otherwise, there is nothing else. This graph will be related. Non-negative irreducible matrices and the positive matrices are somewhat related. How? What is the relation between non-negative matrices and non-negative irreducible and positive matrices? How they are related? Huh? No, not Perron Frobenius. Can you say that any non-negative matrix is a any non-negative irreducible matrix is a positive matrix? Can I say that any non-negative irreducible matrix is a positive matrix? What do you say? No. Yeah. It's a trivial, right? The example that I gave you first, zeros on the diagonal. Okay, this example, it's not non-negative. Okay, it's non-negative as well as irreducible, but it's not positive. Diagonals are zeros. Okay, but whereas the converse is true. If you have a positive matrix, it's a non-negative. That's okay. It is also irreducible because there are no zero entries. Okay, so positive matrices are non-negative irreducible matrices. Okay. So, if I prove the theorem for non-negative irreducible matrices, so it applicable for also positive matrices, okay. Anyway, see, let A be an n by n irreducible matrix and non-negative, irreducible non-negative matrix, okay. Then, I plus A times, okay, I plus A power n minus 1 will be positive matrix, okay. Anyway, see, this one you can get it after certain arguments, okay. So, don't worry about this one, okay. I will assume this one. In fact, it is an if and only statement. If it is irreducible and non-negative, then I plus A power n minus 1 should be positive. If I plus A power n minus 1 is positive, then the matrix should be irreducible as well as non-negative. Sorry, no. If I plus A power n minus 1 is positive, okay, you start with a non-negative matrix. So, when you can say that it is irreducible or not, so then this condition inequality characterizes, okay. In fact, even you can show that if A is irreducible, then there are k positive, n positive numbers, so that k naught into I plus k1 A plus k2 A square till k n minus 1 into A power n minus 1 is positive. Okay. This statement is somewhat stronger here. That's only a special case. I plus A power n minus 1 is positive is only a special case. Why? If I know this one, then I can get that one. I plus A power n minus 1 is positive. Why? How? All the numbers are... binomial expansion, okay. Binomial expansion, these numbers k0, k1, k2, after all, they are the coefficients in the binomial expansion, okay. I plus a power n minus 1, you expand it. What will you get? I plus nc1 into a power a plus nc2 into a square and so on, okay. This nc2 is what? Nc2 is k2, okay. Anyway, see, this ends with this one. Irreducible matrices part is over. So, we will move on to the proof of this one, okay, for irreducible matrices. Anyway, see, another 45 minutes, I will prove this one, okay, yeah, Frobenius theorem. Yeah, you move on to this. Frobenius. No, Frobenius theorem. No, no, not this one. Frobenius theorem. Ah, yes, this one. Yeah, go to the first slide. And this is the first slide. Okay, okay, see. This is a theorem by Frobenius, okay. He extended this Perron theorem, okay. A is non-negative and also irreducible. That's the assumption. Okay, order of A, I am going to assume that it's greater than 1. With 1, I can do nothing. Okay, so that is only one entry. Order of the matrix is at least 2. That's the assumption. A greater than or equal to 0, B a irreducible matrix of order n. Then the following conclusions are valid. Rho of A, spectral radius is always an eigenvalue of A. That's a theorem. Sorry, that's the first conclusion. Second conclusion, positive eigenvector associated with rho of A. Same conclusion as in the Perron theorem. No non-negative eigenvector is associated with any other eigenvalue of A, okay, and the row of A is simple. Simple means algebraic multiplicity is 1, okay. So, in short, all the conclusions of the Perron's theorem are valid for non-negative irreducible matrices, okay, that's the theorem, okay. So, if you have understood Perron's theorem, then it's only one line. All the conclusions of Perron's theorem are valid for non-negative irreducible matrices, okay. Anyways, I will prove this theorem, okay. Proof is not that much, it's not direct, okay. I won't say that it's very difficult, but it's not direct. If you manipulate something, then it will come. But I have to use the characterizations of this irreducible matrix. See, if I start with the definition directly, P transpose AP in that special form, doesn't have, it's not in the special form, then I can do nothing. Unless I can relate irreducible matrices with the positive matrices, I won't get the proof. Okay, so remember this one. So the characterization that I will be using is I plus A power n minus 1 becomes positive. Okay, I plus A square, I plus A power cube and so on up to I plus A power n minus 1. At the n minus 1th power, it becomes a positive matrix. Okay, now I can appeal to Perron's theorem. Okay, and then I can use Perron's theorem and then get the proof. So that's the technique I will be doing this one here. So, okay, see. Okay, first thing is that, okay, see the proof, so before you start proving this one, okay, one thing you see, you have to observe, suppose okay, see, suppose A, suppose the theorem is true, okay, suppose the theorem is true, okay, okay, see how I did the Perron's theorem here. See, Perron's theorem proof, see, suppose you don't know, see, assume that you are in the starting stage of this one, the Perron's theorem proof, okay, you want to show that Perron's theorem is true. Then, see, if you compute A transpose, so if you work with the A transpose, so then for that A, if the Perron's theorem is true, then A transpose, for that A transpose also, spectral radius of A must be an eigenvalue, okay. So, in between you prove this one, okay, and then you conclude this Perron's theorem, okay. So, in between something you conclude, okay. So that's the same technique here. See, let A be irreducible n by n and non-negative. Okay, then I plus A power n minus 1 is positive. Okay, this is given to you. Okay, what you know is I plus A power n minus 1 is positive. So anyway, let me write a rho in place of rho of A. Okay, for short. Okay, and R is the spectral radius of I plus A power n minus 1. That is rho of I plus A power n minus 1 is R. Okay, always remember this one. Okay, so this number is denoted by R, spectral radius of I plus A power n minus 1, okay. First step in the proof will be to show that 1 plus rho power n minus 1, okay, 1 plus rho power n minus 1 is less than or equal to R, okay, 1 plus rho power n minus 1 is less than or equal to R. See, this is not a guess. See, how I got this one? See, if rho is an eigenvalue, then do you agree that this is immediately true or not? See, if rho is an eigenvalue, then this inequality is definitely true. It should be true. Why? Why? Okay, assume that rho is an eigenvalue of A, okay? Then for I plus A power n minus 1, 1 plus rho power n minus 1 is an eigenvalue, okay? Eigenvalue, and definitely it is less than or equal to the spectral radius of I plus A power n minus 1, okay? But at this stage, I don't know whether this is rho is an eigenvalue or not, that's what I have to prove, okay? But you have a guess here, at least this inequality should be true first, okay? So we will prove this inequality, and then this inequality will be, you can use very nicely so that you get the proof, okay? So I will show that 1 plus rho power n minus 1 is less than or equal to R, okay? So this is the first step in the proof. Step 1 should be, will be to show the above inequality, okay? Okay, see, I will start with any eigenvalue, okay? Ax equal to lambda x where x is not 0. I will compute m of ax notation already I introduced, okay? To each of the component, you have to take the modulus. M of ax equal to m of lambda x, okay? And I told you that m of lambda x is always mod lambda into m of x, okay? Consider the lambda for which mod lambda is rho, okay? For some lambda, modulus of lambda should be the rho, okay? Already I know this inequality, m of ax less than or equal to A times m of x. I started this lecture by showing this inequality, okay? Use all these inequalities, okay? Use all these inequalities. That is m of ax less than or equal to A into m of x, plus, also I know that m of ax is always a non-negative vector, okay? So let me use all these things and then get the proof, okay? M of ax equal to mod lambda into m of x. I have taken lambda in such a way that mod lambda is rho, okay? So it is equal to rho times m of x, okay? And I know that it is less than or equal to A times m of x, okay? What we need is only the last part, okay? Rho times m of x is less than or equal to A times m of x, okay? Rho times m of x is less than or equal to A times A into m of x. Now multiply by rho, okay? Multiply by rho. So rho square times m of x is less than or equal to rho times A into m of x, okay? Just a simple multiplication, okay? Rho is a non-negative, so I am multiplying this one, okay? So equal to A times rho into m of x, okay? A into rho times m of x, just I am using the linearity here, nothing else. But this is correct, right? No, no, this is correct or not? It's correct or wrong? I think this is all right, isn't it? No, mod ax is less than or equal to A times mod x, right? That's correct. That's what I have said, mod ax is always less than or equal to A times mod x. That's correct. This is inequality they proved, that I proved, not the other way, okay? Always remember like this, modulus of ax is less than or equal to A times, see, suppose you have alpha x plus beta y, okay? If you take the whole modulus, it will be less than or equal to alpha times mod x plus beta times mod y, okay? The individual mod should come only in the right hand side, okay? So A times mod x, okay? See, anyways, I am multiplying by rho, okay? And then A times rho m of x. A times rho m of x is what? A times rho m of x is A square times, okay? It is less than or equal to, okay? It is less than or equal to A square times m of x. I am applying that second inequality again, okay? Rho times m of x is less than or equal to A times m of x, that I am applying here, okay? The last inequality, so to get this one, A square times m of x, okay? So in general, for any k, rho power k into m of x is less than or equal to A power k times m of x, okay? See, don't bother much about this technicalities, if you work it will come, okay? Nothing great involved here, okay? Once you know this one, once you know rho times m of x is less than or equal to A times m of x, then you multiplying by rho, you will get this inequality, okay? Rho power k into m of x less than or equal to A power k into m of x, okay? From this inequality, okay, it is valid for any k, okay? Any positive integer k, this inequality is valid. So from this, I can conclude that 1 plus rho power n minus 1 into m of x is less than or equal to I plus A power n minus 1 into m of x. Why? How do I get this inequality? See, it's very simple. Apply the first inequality and then deduce the second inequality. How? What is the step involved there? Expansion. Yeah, just you have to expand. See, 1 plus rho power n minus 1. Okay, 1 plus rho power n minus 1, always you have this binomial expansion. Okay. In the first inequality, I can always multiply positive numbers here. Okay, I will take some positive number, say alpha. Okay, I can multiply by the right hand side by alpha, right left hand side by alpha, and right hand side by alpha. Okay. Yeah, that's all. Yeah. Okay, so 1 plus rho power n minus 1, it is a polynomial with the positive coefficients. Okay, I plus a power n minus 1, the matrices are all, to corresponding to every matrix, okay, the each summon will be having only positive coefficient there, I plus a power n minus 1 also, because after all what you are doing there, binomial expansion only. Okay, so 1 plus rho power n minus 1 into m of x is less than or equal to I plus a power n minus 1 into m of x. Okay, now I can apply Perron's theorem to the transpose of I plus a power n minus 1. Do you agree this one or not? For Perron's theorem is, I can apply it, this Perron's theorem to I plus a power n minus 1. Why? I plus a power n minus 1 is a positive matrix. So, to its transpose also I can apply Perron's theorem. Okay. So, there is a Y such that Y transpose, see I am doing the left multiplication here. Okay. Y transpose into I plus a power n minus 1 equal to R into Y transpose, where y is a positive vector, and r already I have taken it to be this one, spectral radius of I plus a power n minus 1. Okay, so now I will use 1 here. Okay, 1 plus rho power n minus 1 into y transpose into m of x is less than or equal to r into y transpose m of x. Okay, very simple, nothing great here. Okay, y transpose m of x is always positive. Why? Y is a positive vector, m of x is a non-negative vector, so y transpose m of x, okay, that's a dot product between y and m of x, it should give you only positive number. So y transpose m of x is a positive number, so y transpose m of x I can cancel. Okay, so what is the remaining thing left out here? 1 plus rho power n minus 1 less than or equal to r. So that's the inequality that I wanted. Okay, so using this inequality I will show that rho is an eigenvalue of a. Okay, this is a step 2 here. Okay, see, first one I will enumerate all the eigenvalues of A. Okay, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 up to alpha n. Anyway, it's an n by n matrix, so there will be at least n complex numbers which are the eigenvalues of A. I am calling them by alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 up to alpha n. Now I can write down all the eigenvalues of I plus A power n minus 1. Okay, see, very simple result. If A is an n by n matrix, and if you write a polynomial P of A, okay, suppose lambda is an eigenvalue of A. For P of A, P of lambda is an eigenvalue. Okay, P of lambda is an eigenvalue. It follows because A square has the eigenvalue lambda square, A cube has eigenvalue lambda cube. Okay, and K times A will have the eigenvalue K times lambda. So polynomial only linear combination. So P of A, the eigenvalue is P of lambda. Okay. So I can, once I have written down all the eigenvalues of A, I can write down all the eigenvalues of I plus a power n minus 1. So what are the eigenvalues of I plus a power n minus 1? In the place of I have to substitute 1. In the place of A, I have to substitute alpha i's. So 1 plus alpha I power n minus 1. Okay, so I have written down all the eigenvalues. 1 plus alpha 1 power n minus 1, 1 plus alpha 2 power n minus 1, and so on. Okay, there are n eigenvalues of I plus a power n minus 1. Okay. I plus a power n minus 1 is positive because I am starting only with a irreducible matrix. Perron's, by Perron's theorem, spectral radius r is an eigenvalue of I plus a power n minus 1. Okay, so for some k, r should be like this, modulus of 1 plus k power n minus 1. Okay, r and this value, they are equal. So mu is alpha k. Okay, let me call mu by alpha k. From step 1, I know that 1 plus rho power n minus 1 less than equal to r, already I proved this one. Okay, so 1 plus rho power n minus 1, okay, is less than or equal to modulus of 1 plus mu power n minus 1. Okay, this up to this step, because I have to get the proof, but there is nothing wrong, right? Huh? Whether it will be used or not, you tell me then after the proof. but it's correct, right? But nothing wrong, right? See, you can tell me if there's something is wrong. Okay. Anyway, I have not done a mistake. Okay. So, yeah, see, without writing modulus also you can do. Okay. Not a big problem. See, 1 plus rho power n minus 1 less than or equal to modulus of n. Okay, yeah, it's all right or not. Okay. This inequality is clear, right? Okay. See, one thing is that, see, you have the power is n minus 1 on both the sides. Okay, power is n minus 1 on both the sides. Okay, and they are all positive numbers. 1 plus rho, modulus of 1 plus mu, they are all positive numbers. Okay, I can take the n minus 1th root. Okay, so 1 plus rho less than or equal to 1 plus mu. Okay, just I am simply taking the this one. Okay, n minus 1th root. So, also, modulus of 1 plus mu is less than or equal to 1 plus mod mu. It's a trivial. Okay. Okay, is it all right? Okay, see, modulus of 1 plus mu less than or equal to 1 plus mod mu. Okay, see, this is true for any complex number. Okay. Mu equal to alpha k is one of the eigenvalues of k, or of a. Okay, so mod mu is less than or equal to rho of a, that's trivial. Okay, that is nothing to do here. Okay, mod mu is always less than or equal to rho of a. Now, write all the inequalities. Okay, 1 plus rho is less than or equal to modulus of 1 plus mu, less than or equal to 1 plus mod mu. Okay. And one of mod mu less than or equal to rho. So, finally, it will be less than or equal to 1 plus rho. Okay. So, what can I conclude from this inequality? Left hand side, I have 1 plus rho. And right hand side, I have, at the end also, I have 1 plus rho. Okay. In between, I have two numbers. Okay. So, conclusion is that these two numbers should coincide. Okay. So, modulus of 1 plus mu should be 1 plus mod mu. Does it imply that mu is greater than or equal to 0? Mod 1 plus mu, a complex number satisfies this property. Modulus of 1 plus mu equal to 1 plus mod mu. Then mu must be non-negative. Is it all right? How will you prove this one? Modulus of 1 plus mu equal to modulus of 1 plus mu. Prove that. First of all, prove that mu is real. How will you prove that mu is real? If you prove that mu is real, then mu should be non-negative. Okay, how will you prove that mu is real? Any complex number satisfying this equation should be a real number. Why? How will you prove this one? Just a complex numbers you have to work. How will you prove? Square on both the sides. See, whenever you have a modulus, don't keep that modulus as such. Okay. Best strategy will be to square it. Okay. So, put your, so I know that this square is this square. Okay, now how will you prove this one? What is modulus of 1 plus mu square? 1 plus mu, 1 plus mu bar equal to 1 plus mod mu square plus 2 times mod mu. Okay, so this is, expand this one. Okay, 1 plus, okay, this is mu bar is mod mu square. Then, okay, this terms comes out nicely. Mu plus its conjugate. Okay, conjugate. 2 times will be there. No, no. No, no, these things get cancelled. So, ultimately you have 2 times mod mu is mu plus 1. Okay. So, mu plus mu bar by 2 equal to mod mu. Okay, this is mod mu. So d equal to real part of mu. Okay, but how will you how does it follow that mu is real? Now I know that mod mu equal to real part of mu. Okay, mod mu is real part of mu. Then how will you how does it follow that mu is actually a real number? See, if I have a non-zero, see, geometrically, don't draw pictures. I don't want to draw any picture and then, okay, see, a very simple argument. If you have a non-zero imaginary part, okay, and if you calculate the modulus, it will definitely exceed the real part, modulus of the real part. So, non-zero, so the imaginary part should have only zero component. So that's why mu should be real. See, I have explained to you, if it is not convincing, write down mu equal to a plus ib, okay, and then work it out, at least in one page you will get a contradiction. Okay, is it all right or not? Okay, so mu must be real, okay, but once mu is real, mu is also non-negative, why? Mu is always, see, if mu is less than zero, then that equation cannot hold. See, 1 plus mu, if mu is less than zero, okay, if mu is less than zero, then what will I get? If mu is less than 0, then no, otherwise I can also work with this one. 1 minus 1 plus mu equal to modulus of mu. Is it all right? Minus mod mu, right? No, is it all right or not from that equation? Minus 1 plus this side, okay, from that does it follow that mu is greater than or equal to 0? Mu is greater than or equal to 0, okay, see, if mu is less than 0, then what will happen? 1 plus mu, left hand side is? No, if mu is minus 3, then what will happen? Okay, that's not a correct argument. It will work only for this one, okay. So, anyway, see, mu is greater than or equal to 0, then how will you conclude this one? 1 plus mod mu, mu is greater than or equal to 0. Something is missing here, so okay, see, I have shown that real part of mu is modulus of mu, okay, real part of mu is modulus of mu. Does it mean that it is greater than or equal to 0 or not? See, I can do nothing with that equation. Real part of mu equal to modulus of mu, that's what I proved, okay. Mu, real part of mu should be greater than or equal to 0. Otherwise, how can be? It will be equal to mod mu. If it is negative, then how can it's equal to modulus of? Okay. It has nothing to do with that equation. From this, it follows directly that mu is greater than or equal to 0. Okay. Is it all right or not? Okay. See, don't look at this one. See, don't substitute if mu is negative, then you will get this one. No, it's not like that. I have shown that mod mu equal to real part of mu, that shows that mu is greater than or equal to 0, okay, it's not negative, okay. No, don't use this one, don't use that, if you use that equation you will not get it. That's an incorrect argument. Suppose I substitute mu equal to minus 3, then the both the sides will be equal, right? Don't be. Okay, right. Okay, it's all right. Yeah. Okay, because that number gets subtracted. Okay, I need not do anything. I already have the equation on the board. So why should I struggle for mu greater than or equal to 0? I know that mod mu is real part of mu. So mu should be greater than or equal to 0. Okay. Rho is less than or equal to. So this also gives you, okay, if I cancel 1 on both the sides, okay, it says that mod mu less than or equal to rho. So that means that, I have to work on this left hand side, sorry. 1 plus rho less than or equal to 1 plus mod mu. So rho less than or equal to mod mu. Okay, that's a non-trivial part. Mod mu less than or equal to rho is a trivial part. because spectral radius always dominates, okay. So 1 plus rho less than or equal to 1 plus mod mu. So this means that rho less than or equal to mod mu. So both the numbers should coincide, mu should be rho, okay. Mu should be rho, and already mu is an eigenvalue of A. So mu should be the spectral radius. So spectral radius is the eigenvalue of A. So I have shown that spectral radius is always an eigenvalue of a irreducible non-negative matrix, okay. First assertion of the Frobenius theorem is complete, okay. First assertion is complete. So second assertion, if x is an eigenvector of A associated with rho, then now we now show the following, okay. M of x is an eigenvector of A and M of x is positive, okay. M of x is positive. This M of x and all comes from this one, okay. See, the idea of the proof is that, see, I have started with this inequality, okay. Suppose there is a strict inequality, then you will get a contradiction, okay. So okay, complete the proofing is, it's very simple. Actually, we have done the proof that M of x is an eigenvector. If you see the proof carefully, we have already done the proof, okay. Anyway, see, I will just go back to this proof again. Say I start with this one, Ax equal to rho of x. I know that rho is an eigenvalue now. So Ax equal to rho x, x naught equal to 0, but initially x is in Cn, okay. I am going to show that x is positive, okay. M of Ax equal to M of rho x, okay, equal to rho times M of x by the definition of M of x, okay, nothing else. Already we know that M of Ax less than equal to A times M of x, okay. Suppose M of AX equal to A times M of X, then I am done, okay. Is it all right or not? That's what I am required to do. M of X is an eigenvector, okay. M of X will be an eigenvector corresponding to this one, okay. So problem occurs only when the inequality is strict, okay. So now assume that it's a strict inequality and then get a contradiction. So I am going to assume that M of AX is strictly less than A times M of X, okay. But M of AX equal to what? M of rho X equal to rho times M of X. Always remember this one, okay. So M of AX is strictly less than M of A into M of X. That's my assumption. This implies that rho times M of X is less than A times M of X, okay. I am doing the same step again, okay. Now multiply by rho and then conclude that rho square into M of x is strictly less than A square times M of x. In general, for any k, rho power k into M of x is strictly less than A power k into M of x, okay. If f is any polynomial with a positive coefficients, then f of rho into M of x is less than f of a into M of x, okay. This already I have explained you, okay. So I define the polynomial like this, g of delta equal to 1 plus delta power n minus 1. It's a polynomial with the positive coefficients, okay. So g of rho into M of x is less than or equal to g of a into M of x, okay. So 1 plus rho power n minus 1 into M of x is strictly less than I plus a into n minus 1 into M of x, okay. As before, rho r is the spectral radius of I plus a power n minus 1, okay. Apply Perron's theorem, okay. Apply Perron's theorem to I plus a power n minus 1 to the transpose of I plus a power n minus 1, okay. I have written just I plus a power n minus 1. So y transpose into I plus a power n minus 1 is r y transpose, okay. So we have 1 plus rho power n minus 1 into M of x less than I plus a power n minus 1 into M of x, and y plus y transpose into I plus a power n minus 1 equal to y transpose r by Perron's theorem, okay. Now multiply by y transpose in the first inequality, okay. So then you will be getting 1 plus rho, cancelling y transpose M of x. You can cancel y transpose M of x because it's going to be a positive number. So it will be 1 plus r rho power n minus 1 will be strictly less than r. It's a contradiction. I know that these two numbers are exactly same, okay. So see, since I have done the proof, I have gone through very fast, okay. So same proof, whatever I have done, in that inequality should be replaced by equality, that's all. By Perron's theorem, r must be an eigenvalue of I plus a power n minus 1, okay. If f is a polynomial and lambda is an eigenvalue of A, then f of lambda is an eigenvalue of A. So it's an elementary result in a linear algebra. So denote the eigenvalues of A by alpha 1 up to alpha n. Then the eigenvalues of g of A are 1 plus alpha 1 power n minus 1, 1 plus alpha 2 power n minus 1, and so on. Okay, r is an eigenvalue, and 1 plus alpha k power n minus 1, beta, I am calling this number to beta. So we have R equal to one plus mu power n minus one, already we have one plus rho power n minus one into is less than R. Okay, so this will give you one plus rho is less than one plus rho power is less than modulus of one plus mu. So finally you will get this contradiction, rho less than mod mu. I think these things are not needed, whatever I said, that itself, that will finish the theorem there itself. Okay, see, these things are not needed, they are all over explanation. This step itself will complete the proof. Okay, so see, I have done everything in detail. Okay, so if you see the things carefully, then see that everything is under. Okay, see, one thing left out in the proof is that, okay, I have shown that for an irreducible non-negative matrix, okay, you have a non-negative vector associated with that spectral radius. Okay, but what is the guarantee that the non-negative vector is actually a positive vector? Okay, so m of x should be positive, some component may be zero. Okay, so that cannot happen, that's the proof. Okay, so that's what you are going to claim. Claim is m of x is greater than zero. A power k into m of x equal to rho power k into m of x. Okay, that's that follows from the fact that a into m of x equal to rho into m of x. Okay, so define g, okay, I will define this one, g of delta equal to 1 plus delta power n minus 1. So g of rho into m of x is g of a into m of x. Okay, g of a is a positive matrix. Okay, m of x is non-negative. Okay, m of x is non-negative, but by Perron's theorem I know that I can have only positive vector associated with the Perron value. Okay, so m of x should be really positive. Okay, so once again I am appealing to Perron's theorem and then concluding that this m of x is actually positive. Okay, so this argument also you can't skip. Okay, so it doesn't follow directly that m of x is actually positive. So some component, if it is zero, then what will you do? Unless you appeal to this argument, you can't conclude this one. Anyway, see, to show the remaining things, okay, so you need this one. If A is a non-negative irreducible matrix, then Ax equal to rho x for some x positive. Okay, up to this one you have proved. Okay, next one says that from the arguments we have seen so far, this A of x equal to rho of x implies that 1 plus I plus A power n minus 1 into x equal to 1 plus rho power n minus 1 into x. Okay, but I can use the fact that I plus A power n minus 1 is positive. Okay, and 1 plus rho power n minus 1 is the spectral radius of I plus A power n minus 1. So this is actually the Perron vector of 1 plus rho power n minus 1 is the Perron vector of what? I plus A power n minus 1. Okay, so the geometric multiplicity of rho should be 1. Is it alright or not? If the, say, if you have another vector Ay equal to rho y, okay, then I can conclude that I plus A power n minus 1 into y is equal to 1 plus rho power n minus 1 into y. Okay, that will contradict the Perron's theorem, because already I have proved in the Perron's theorem that geometric multiplicity is 1. So from that it follows that the geometric multiplicity of rho is 1. Okay, so okay, now anyways, whatever he told, so I am introducing this one. Rho of A is called the Perron root of A or Perron value of A, whatever you call. Okay, for an irreducible non-negative matrix, rho of A is called the Perron eigenvalue of A. Associated vector is called the Perron vector. Algebraic multiplicity of rho is 1. This is yet to be proved. Okay, I have not proved this one. I have shown that only geometric multiplicity is 1. Okay, so anyway, note, this will imply that geometric multiplicity is 1. Why? Okay, gm less than or equal to am. Okay, gm means, I don't think that what is that, geometric mean less than or equal to arithmetic mean, not that. Geometric multiplicity less than or equal to algebraic multiplicity of that, okay, half lambda, that is also important. Geometric multiplicity of lambda less than or equal to algebraic multiplicity of lambda. Okay, okay, see, I will prove it very easily. Okay, suppose rho is not a simple eigenvalue of A. Okay, that is, in other words, it has algebraic multiplicity 2. Algebraic multiplicity is at least 2. Okay, at least 2. At least 2 means, what is the meaning for that? See, algebraic multiplicity of lambda is at least 2. What is the meaning for that? Okay, it has, if you solve the characteristic polynomial, okay, that factor comes out at least 2 times. Okay, that is x minus rho, at least you have 2 power 2 there. Okay, that's the meaning for that. It is not simple. Okay, remember this one. Okay, see, it's a simple exercise here. Okay, I will anyway show, I have a slide, return slide, okay, how to do this exercise. There exists V and W, so that AV equal to rho V and then AW equal to V plus rho W. If you know Jordan canonical form, it's well and good. Otherwise, there is no need for using Jordan canonical form here. Directly, you can prove this one, okay. AV equal to rho V and then AW equal to V plus rho W. Okay, see, if you know how to prove a triangular form, then you can easily write the proof for this one. Anyway, I will show you the proof, okay, if I have time. And also, if the slide comes properly, because, okay. Anyway, see, accept this one, okay. Accept this one, AV equal to rho V and then AW equal to V plus rho times W, okay. We have V positive, okay. We have V positive by Perron-Frobenius theorem. Okay, now I am going to, okay, see, there is a mistake here, a minus rho times I, okay, this is a minus I have written, a minus rho times I. So y transpose into a minus rho I into W equal to, okay, what is this actually, this one is, anyway, see, compute this one. AV is V, AW is V plus rho W, okay. V and W are not zero, okay. V and W are not zero, then, and also they are linearly independent, okay. In fact, linearly independent means they cannot be zero, okay. So, V is positive. We have V is positive, and then here. So, see, I work with this one, A minus rho times I of V is 0, okay, A minus V times V is 0. So, this is AW, A minus rho times I, W is V, okay. Now, multiply, pre-multiply by Y transpose, okay. So, Y transpose, okay. Y be the left Perron vector of A, but in other words, left Perron vector means what? A transpose, okay, A transpose Y equal to rho times Y, okay. So, this is, okay, what is this actually? Y transpose A, if you compute, this is actually rho times Y transpose minus rho times Y transpose, okay, this W comes here, okay, rho times Y transpose W, okay, this is 0, these two numbers are equal. Z is 0. So, Y transpose V is 0. Okay. But Y transpose V cannot be 0. Why? See, Y is a Perron vector. So, Y is positive. Okay. And V is also positive. You take the dot product of two positive vectors. It is positive. So, it cannot be 0. Okay. Very, very simple argument. Okay. See, there are other proofs also. If you use that one, it's somewhat lengthy. Okay. But if you use this exercise, it comes immediately. Okay, anyway, this is a final assertion here. Suppose you have a non-negative vector, okay, alpha not equal to rho, and suppose you have a non-negative vector, then get a contradiction. Okay, one of you asked me how to do this one. It's an exercise for, okay, exercise for you, it's the same as doing this Perron theorem, okay. Work with the left Perron vectors, it will come, okay. No, see. How will you prove this one? Alpha not equal to rho. Yeah, work with the left Perron vector. It will. Anyway, see, I will stop with this one. Okay. Further things I may not go into. Okay. What happens for reducible non-negative matrices? You can say something about reducible non-negative matrix also. What can be said about principal submatrix of a non-negative matrix? Okay, all these questions can be answered. Okay, see, Perron-Frobenius theorem further goes into that. Okay, so anyway, I will not do this one. Maybe in another 5 minutes, I will show you how to do this exercise. Okay, if rho is not a simple eigenvalue, then you can find V and W so that AV equal to rho V and AW equal to V plus rho W. But see whether that comes properly or not. So I think it can be done. So. And that AM, GM, so. Okay, see, lemma, suppose A is an n by n matrix. Okay, lambda is an eigenvalue of A. Assume that a geometric multiplicity is strictly less than algebraic multiplicity. Okay, of that particular eigenvalue, lambda. Then you can find two vectors, V and W, such that AV equal to lambda V, and then AW equal to V plus lambda times W. Okay, V plus lambda times W. See, this exercise, you can do it in even a very simpler way. I asked one of my colleague, he gave even a simpler proof. But anyway, that's not appealing to me, so I wrote my own proof, which is lengthier also, you may not like it. Okay, anyway, see, bear with me. Now, without loss of generality, assume that lambda is 0. You can always do that. Okay, because you can always subtract by that one. Okay, A minus lambda. I will work with A minus lambda otherwise. Okay. You prove for the simple case, okay, lambda equal to 0. Then that will go through for any non-zero case also. So, AP is 0 times P1. Okay, for norm, P, it's a P is not 0. So, I will scale it and then assume that it's it has a magnitude 1. Okay. Without loss of generality, I will assume that algebraic multiplicity of 0 is 2 and the geometric multiplicity is 1. Other cases are simpler. See, this is the most difficult case. If the algebraic multiplicity is more than 2, and then it's even simpler than that, this one, okay. So, in this case, you prove this one, okay. Define U equal to P1, P2, P3 up to Pn, so that U is unitary. This one always I can do. First vector I am taking it as P1. Remaining vectors I will fill so that this forms an orthogonal basis for Cn. Okay, so if you know Gram-Schmidt process, you can do this one. Okay, so AU is AP1, AP2 up to APN. This matrix multiplication already I have explained you. Okay, so equal to 0 times P1, Q2 up to Qn. Okay, now I am computing U star AU. Okay, U star AU is 0, U star U2 up to U star U, Qn. Okay, and then these vectors I am calling it as V2 up to Vn. Okay, just can you come below? So, U star AU, okay, write down it as a full matrix, okay, first column is 0, 0, 0, and then V21, V22 up to V2n, okay, and then V1, okay, and then consider only that principal submatrix, okay, which I have boxed, so that I call it as B, okay. Now, you can find P such that P star V2 up to P star BP is in such a way that the first columns become 0, okay, this is always possible, why? No, this is possible. Why? In this case, it's possible. Because I am going to assume that algebraic multiplicity is 2. Okay. See, that 0 comes here. Okay. The remaining, see, first entry in U star AU is what? 0. Remaining things are zeros. Okay. So, eigenvalues of U star AU are precisely 0 and the eigenvalues of this boxed matrix. Okay. So, in that B also 0 should be an eigenvalue, then only the algebraic multiplicity can be 2, okay. So, find P so that P star into that B into P is 0, 0, 0 up to this one, okay. So, A, okay, this is because A may algebraic multiplicity is at least 2, okay. Now, I will define P tilde, okay. P tilde is 1, 0, 0 P. It's easy to verify that P tilde is unitary. If you, I am assuming that P star P is unitary, okay. Then this P tilde will also be unitary, okay. And now you define P V equal to P tilde into U. If you multiply two unitary matrices, it will be unitary, okay. So V star A U, if you compute, okay, it gives you 0 in the first column, okay. And then the second column is something like this, eta, and then the first, I know that already these entries are zeros. In the second column, okay, 0, 0, 0. First entry only, I don't have any control, okay, eta. Okay, remaining things I don't care, okay. I just put the filling like this, Q11, Q21 and then so on, okay. Okay, if eta is 0, then what happens? Then V star AV, okay, eta cannot be 0, because otherwise the geometric multiplicity will become 2, okay. I am assuming the geometric multiplicity is 1, okay. So, eta is not 0. So, okay, if eta is not 0, then V star AV is 0, eta E1 and so on, okay. So, anyway, come below here, AV1, okay, V star AV1, okay, V star AV1 is 0, that means, but V is invertible, so AV1 should be 0, V star into AV2 is eta into E1. So AV2 is eta into V acting on E1, so which is the first column of V1. Okay, so AV1 is 0, AV2 is eta into V1, which is 0 plus eta into V1, which is the required thing. See, the proof is, proof comes by, why I like this proof is that you teach a triangular form for your students. Okay, very easily you can prove this one, if you know Schur's theorem, Schur's unitary theorem, okay, how to prove this one, Schur's unitary theorem, same thing. Okay, just we have to make some minor modification here, so it comes very nicely here. Otherwise, you have to work with range space, column space and so on, but that proof is simple, within four lines you can conclude. But this is only through matrix multiplication. No, the thing is that in this proof, I have not used any other thing except matrix multiplication, if you see carefully. Okay, other than that, I have not used anything, I used the definition of algebraic multiplicity, geometric multiplicity and then matrix multiplication, more than that, I have not used any other technique, so it comes out nicely. Okay, other things you have to go through, okay, otherwise you have to, if you write a simpler proof than this, then you have to appeal to some other thing and then prove this, okay, it's very simple. Okay, so anyway, leave this one, okay, that. Okay, thanks.